This is TWiT.
So let's talk about nothing. What was before the Big Bang? What?
There are many answers to that question, but the simplest one is it's not a good question.
Well, I got the bad question out of the way.
I mean, the reason I wrote that book is the idea that we can get 100 billion galaxies, each containing 100 billion stars, when there wasn't anything to begin with. That seems to require some divine intervention. And what's amazing is, given what we know about the laws of physics now, it doesn't require that. But the reason before the Big Bang might not be a good question is that we, as I describe in the book, it's quite possible, indeed plausible, that our entire universe spontaneously popped into existence from nothing. That's all of space, but it's also time, because in general relativity, space and time are connected. So if space emerged from nothing, it could be that time emerged from nothing. There literally was no before. Time made no sense. And of course, if that's the case, we have to change a lot of our views, because everything we think of about cause and effect involves a before and after. And you know, we don't have a full theory of quantum gravity yet, but we realize that we may have to change the way we think. And that's okay. Some people get upset that science, as I've just said, described in my book, sort of redefines nothing to be something from which something can arise. And some people say, well, you know, that's not my definition of nothing. And I say, that's fine, but I don't care, because, you know, science changes the definition of things. As I point out, it's called learning.
Yeah. Amazing.
But what is it? If you ask, what are the characteristics of a universe that could have come from nothing without any supernatural shenanigans? Our universe has precisely those characteristics. And so that doesn't prove it, because we don't have a theory of quantum gravity, but it makes it plausible. And that plausibility is worth celebrating. That seeming miracle that you can get matter from no matter, that the entire energy of the universe can be precisely zero, is amazing. Now, it doesn't answer the question, you know, is there something other than our universe? Is our universe part of something larger? Did it pop into existence from something else? And I talk about that in the book. And it could be, we think now, that there may be something called a multiverse, which may have an infinite number of universes in it. And that may be eternal and pre-existing, and it could be that there is some global time, that there are universes being created right now and other ones dying. So there may be a global time, and our universe may just have arisen 13.8 billion years ago. But that doesn't, in some sense, that multiverse, by the way, plays the role of God, because some people think of God as something outside our universe that's eternal. But we didn't invent it because we needed that solace. The laws of physics seem to be driving us to it. In fact, since I wrote the book, there's been a wonderful discovery. Actually, I've got the cover article in Scientific American, which will come out the day after tomorrow, I guess, is on an amazing discovery that was made 5 months ago now, which may or may not be right, of gravitational waves from the Big Bang.
Yeah.
And as I point out in the book, if those are really there, if that observation is really gravitational waves from the Big Bang, then it pretty well implies there must be other universes out there. And that turns metaphysics into physics. And I find that it blows my mind.
We live in such interesting times, because at the same time as there is an assault on science, there's also amazing science being done. Big science too, like the Large Hadron Collider.
Yeah, in fact, exactly. It is an incredibly exciting time. And it's communicating that excitement that I want to do. We not only did the public pay for this, so we owe it to the public to explain what's going on, but these are some of the most exciting ideas that have ever been, humans have ever come up with. And you know, what amazes me is, well, there's two things that amaze me. One, that somehow people figure you can't be interested in science or even understand or appreciate it if you're not a scientist. But you know, they don't say that about music. You don't have to be Mozart to appreciate Mozart. You don't have to be Picasso to appreciate art, or Shakespeare to appreciate drama. And it's the same with science. We can all appreciate the beauty of those ideas. And by the same token, people often say, you know, they ask me, what's the utility of learning about gravitational waves from the Big Bang? And I say, nothing except understanding where we came from. And somehow people want scientific ideas to always have utility. They always want it to turn into technology. But it's those ideas themselves that change our picture of ourselves. You know, I'm quite proud of the fact that the research I do has no practical use whatsoever. Because
any more
I
than a great symphony does, or
exactly.
a beautiful painting. I mean, that's
exactly. Now it's true that science down the road, even esoteric things, can become practical. In fact, as I talk about and I've written about, you know, I couldn't. I won't be able to, in Los Angeles, where I'm leaving after this interview, I wouldn't be able to get from the airport to where I'm going without GPS, but I couldn't use GPS if it weren't for general relativity and special relativity. Those esoteric things actually are built in those GPS receivers, which would go out of sync in about 3 seconds if we didn't incorporate that. So even esoteric ideas in science can find practical value, but that's not the reason to do it. The reason to do it is because we want to boldly go where no one has gone before.
Back to the physics of Star Trek. There's so many directions. I one thing that you said on the cruise that kind of blew my mind is that we are close to knowing everything. Did you say that? Maybe not you. Maybe it wasn't you.
If I did, then I was
you
dreaming.
You take it back?
We've made great strides. Make great strides, but I suspect and I thoroughly hope there's a lot more about the universe we don't understand than we do.
I must have misunderstood you because that was shocking to me too.
Yeah, that gives job security to a physicist like me. There's a lot more to learn. But it's more than that.
You're not going to pack up your bags and say, we're done. We got it. We're over. We'll go home.
I can't imagine that's ever going to happen. Maybe it will someday. But, you know, there may be an ultimate theory of everything. But or as Richard Feynman said, it could just be like a cosmic onion. We just keep peeling back layers. But it's the learning. It's the exploring. It's knowing more today than we knew yesterday. And being surprised. Every day I wake up and I'm surprised if I'm not surprised. Basically, that's what we couldn't do. That's why sort of science differs from science fiction in another way. We couldn't. The universe, the imagination of the universe is much greater than the imagination of human, either scientists or writers. And if we wrote down the best possible science just based on introspection and revelation, we'd come up with a picture of the universe that would pale in comparison to the real universe because it keeps surprising us. That's why we keep having to open up new windows, keep doing experiments, because common sense is not a guide to what is out there. We have to force our common sense to revise, again, to accommodate the strange and wonderful things. The universe, the expansion of the universe is speeding up over time. It's getting faster and faster and faster. There's a kind of cosmic anti-gravity. Most of the energy of the universe resides in empty space. You take a region of space and you get rid of all the particles and the radiation and everything, and it still weighs something. I mean, who would have thought of that?
I know who said it. It wasn't you. It was Michio Kaku said it.
Michio Kaku is wrong about so many things.
He thinks we're close to a unified field theory.
Well, he may think that, but he's wrong.
I love it.
Like most futurists. By the way, futurists are generally wrong.
Yeah.
Because people often ask me, what's the next great breakthrough? And I say, if I knew, I'd be doing it.
Yeah. Your goal is not to predict the future by any means. Your goal is to study and see what we got.
See where we're going. I tend to try. If I'm going to predict the future, it's 2 trillion years from now. I'm comfortable doing that for two reasons. One, it's simpler. And two, no one will be around to check to see whether I got it wrong. So it doesn't matter.